My name, as Dr. Peter said, is Elizabeth Lyra Ross. Elizabeth comes from both of my grandmothers, and Lyra came from an aunt on my father's side. I have no idea where the Rosses from Columbus, Georgia got Lyra, but I'm named after my aunt Lyra. The name of the format that I would use for this presentation was suggested by my husband, and it's called edutainment. So what I will do, the goal is for you to learn a little bit about me and my music, and also to be entertained. I grew up in Detroit, Michigan. I was first introduced to classical music when, at age 6, my father took me to a concert to see the Detroit Symphony Orchestra. They had a violin soloist, and I was so impressed that I begged my parents for a violin, which I got that next Christmas. After graduating from high school in Detroit, I went to Trinity College here in Hartford for undergraduate school and Indiana University School of Music for grad school. The reason that I selected Summertime as my first song this afternoon is not wishful thinking, although I do wishfully think that summertime would come, but it's from the first opera that I was ever in. And that was Porgy and Bess when I was a student at Indiana University. And Summertime is a lullaby. It's sung by the character Clara as she tries to get her baby to fall asleep. This is Summertime. Listen to the lyrics closely. Even though in bondage, the slaves sang, "No man can hinder me." The selection is called "Ride On, King Jesus."
guess that was kind of loud.
The name of this program, which is printed there, is called My Musical Autobiography. And so there is all different types of music that will be contained in this program. But as I do my narrations, you'll see how all of them have fit into my life. And so you'll know a bit more about me when this is over. Communication amongst the slaves was extremely difficult. Just imagine, it was against the law for them to read or to write, and anyone caught teaching a slave to read or write would be imprisoned or killed. It was also against the law for more than three slaves to gather in a group. Therefore, their main method of communication became music. Does anyone here know what double entendre means? Double entendre is the same exact words are interpreted differently by different people. This next song is a perfect example of double entendre. When the slave owners heard this song, they thought that the slaves were singing about how life on earth is short and that they would soon be seeing Jesus for all eternity. However, the song is not at all about that. The song is about planning escape from the plantation. The lyrics, "I ain't got long to stay here," means that the escape is imminent. The exact time of this escape is set by the line, "My God calls me by the thunder." The next thunderstorm was selected as the escape because it was more difficult to track slaves in the rain. This piece is "Steal Away to Jesus."
Thank you.
next aria that I'm going to sing, and aria is Italian for song, is from the opera Tosca. Floria Tosca is an opera singer. She is in love with the painter, and all she wants to do is sing her songs and be with her boyfriend. However, Tosca's boyfriend is arrested by the chief of police, who has been lusting after Tosca for a long time. And he tells her all she has to do to get him free is to sleep with him. When Tosca sings Visi d'arte, which means I've lived for art, and she sings it in Act 2, she's asking God, why am I in this mess? I found a whole new identification with this song as I was doing push-ups until the ground got tired, as I went on 20-mile road marches with me and my M16 and a backpack. I just wanted to go to D.C. and sing. Why was I going through all this? This is Visi d'arte by Puccini from Tosca.
Listen to Army Band and Chorus. President Reagan gave the Presidential Medal of Freedom, this country's highest civilian honor, to the ragtime pianist and composer, Ubi Blake. Mr. Blake was 98 at the time. He came to Washington, D.C., and we did a concert of all of his music. I inquired and found out that even though Mr. Blake had never been in the military, and I was wondering, you know, why he would get the Medal of Freedom, and I found out that he got it for his service to the Army. And as I was curious as to what his service to the Army was, during World War I and World War II and Korea, the United States Army was segregated. And what that meant was the African-American soldiers were not eligible to attend the entertainments that were put on for the white soldiers. So Mr. Blake spent his own money and brought bands to Europe and to the Far East to entertain not only the black soldiers, but anybody who wanted to come. The piece that I'm going to do today is from the musical Shuffle Along. It opened in 1921, and it was the first show by an African-American composer to play on Broadway. It was also, the song that I'm going to do is called I'm Just Wild About Harry, and it was the first song by an African-American composer to be used for a United States presidential campaign song. Harry Truman used it. What we're going to do today, the song originally was done as a slow waltz, and the lady who sang it in the show wanted Mr. Blake to change it. He wouldn't change it. It was a flop in the show, so he finally decided to do something else, so he changed it to an up-tempo two-step. What we're going to do is to do both versions, and you can decide which one you prefer. This is I'm Just Wild About Harry.
There's just one.
Dr. Peters has said, I performed that last summer in two concerts with the Army Band. So if you want to hear it again, along with a wonderful concert of interesting music, about half of it is patriotic and half of it is all kinds of other stuff. You can look on the program and go on YouTube and go to the Army Band website, and it's under Alumni Concert. There's all kinds of neat stuff on there. Many people tell me that they don't like opera because it doesn't relate to current situations. Un ballo in maschera, which is an opera, is based on the real assassination of the King of Sweden at a masquerade party. The character who sings this aria, Amelia, is having an affair with her husband's boss. Does that ever happen now? She goes to a fortune teller who instructs her to go to the place where executions are held and to pick a flower that only grows in the blood of those who have been executed. When Amelia brings back the flower, which has to be plucked exactly at midnight, the fortune teller will make a special potion out of the flower, and that will free her of this urge that she has for her husband's voice, her husband's boss. The name of this aria is called Ecco l'orrido campo, which means here is that horrible place. And it tells of Amelia's visit to the execution place. And just when she hears the clock striking midnight and she's getting ready to take the flower, and she becomes afraid, she starts hallucinating, and she finally says, as many people do when they're in serious problems today, "Help me, Jesus." Now, Un ballo in maschera was written by a very famous Italian composer, whose name is Giuseppe Verdi, but it's important to know that if he was American, his name would be Joe Green. This is Ecco l'orrido campo.
Thank you.
remembers what was the first, I see you over there. Who remembers the name of the first opera that I was ever in? Very good, very good. That is correct. I've been performing a lot in Porgy and Bess recently. Porgy and Bess was written by the American composer George Gershwin. It takes place in Charleston, South Carolina, and Mr. Gershwin went to South Carolina for 2 years to study the musical and verbal patterns of the people that lived there to make sure that it would be authentic in his piece. And also, in order to keep white performers from doing Porgy and Bess in blackface, George Gershwin put the stipulation in the copyright that the poor performers have to be of African-American descent. Porgy and Bess has been a great vehicle for many African-American singers. I've traveled throughout the United States and Europe and Japan, and I used to say, sing Gershwin and see the world. The character that I sing now is named Serena. In Act One of Porgy and Bess, Serena's husband is killed by Bess's boyfriend. And Act Two begins at the funeral of Serena's husband. Serena has never worked before, and she's trying to get money to bury her husband. The undertaker has told her that he will need $25, and what she has done is she's put a plate on his chest, and all the townspeople have come to give money, but all she's been able to collect is $15. And the undertaker tells her, sorry, you know, call me when you get some more money. He leaves. Then the chief of police comes to the house and tells Serena that this body has been hanging around here for too long. If you don't bury this man tomorrow morning, I will take him and give him to the medical school to be used as an experimental cadaver. And then Serena sings, my man's gone now. reflection today, I have some thank yous. The first thank you goes to Dr. Kirk Peters, Dean of Student Services here at Tosca Community College. Thank you for inviting me here to perform. And for me, this is a three-peat, so I'm very thankful to have been invited back three times. I also would be remiss if I did not mention Dr. Peters' assistant, Chris LaPorte. Chris, where are you? Chris has magical powers. He was able to reserve a parking space, both for me and for my accompanist. So that's magic. So thank you again to Chris, wherever you are. The final thank you goes to my accompanist, Doris Lang Kozloff. Thank you, Doris. Doris is the artistic director of the Connecticut Concert Opera. She's the music director of the Hart Opera Theater and on the faculty at the Hart School of Music at the University of Hartford. Doris conducts both operas in the United States and internationally. And I could not do what I do without Doris. So thank you again. Finally, I have to thank all of you for coming. I know some of it was a command attendance because of your class, but thank all of you who came. I have some friends that have come from far and near, some neighbors and other friends, so thank you for coming out on this crazy day. And I hope that you have been edutained. The last piece that we're going to do, as I was thinking about this being Women's History Month, and when the word diversity is mentioned, discussion of how many different types of people make up the group, one could mention how many women or how many different ethnic groups are present in the group that you're talking about. However, there is not very much attention paid to the diversity within the African American community. My last selection is called For Women, and it was written almost 50 years ago by the late jazz singer Nina Simone, and it describes four African American women of very, very different circumstances. And even though it is 50 years later, all of these ladies are very much a fabric of the African American community. Please listen to these words very carefully and see how many of these ladies you know. This is For Women. Thank you. song that I'm going to do is from the Broadway show Showboat. And also thinking about Women's History Month, although Showboat was written in 1927, it is historically significant because the first time that blacks and whites on Broadway had equal roles in a show. And the show is also unique because there are three different ladies who sing this song. One is a black woman, one is a white woman, and one is a mixed race woman. And I dedicate this song to my husband, who's here with the CDs. And this song is called Can't Help Loving That Man of Mine.